This is AC Interviews, episode 8, and I've got Monzo on the show, like, someone who's been spoken about a lot, and I feel like if someone's putting in the work and, like, they're doing their due diligence, then it's, like, it's a great thing for them to get the light in it, whichever way that comes in. And basically, the way I do my interviews is just like from start to the current, innit? So yeah. I'll start from the beginning and then slowly move to like where we are now. Yeah. But yeah, now where I wanted to start was like, what would you say? Obviously, I've heard in your music you're from Southwest.
Yeah.
And I've heard you're Nigerian as well.
Yeah, that's
correct. So what would you say your early life was like for you?
Early life was like pretty much music throughout my whole life. My dad's a DJ, my sister sings, my brother produces, so it's like just music's literally been in my whole entire family and been in my life throughout that whole time. But just being Nigerian and being from like Southwest London, I feel like I have a different experience to like what London life is, to what a London girl's life is as well. So yeah, that's kind of like what my upbringing is kind of like.
Would you say is there an exact area in Southwest London, or is it all over?
It's Southwest. I'm from Southwest.
Okay, don't get too much ill in that one.
Yeah.
Okay. And like, what would you say? Was it like, obviously not to dig too deep, but is it two parent household, siblings, yeah, all of that?
Yeah. I grew up in a two parent household. I feel like again that's another reason why I have a different experience. My mum loves music, but she doesn't really do it. My dad, very heavily involved in music, so that's kind of like how I was able to, you know, get to where I am today. But yeah, I feel like it was different. But it was a good thing having both my parents. I feel like if I didn't, I'd probably be doing something way more crazier.
Okay.
So, yeah.
And what would you say, what were, like, as a child, like, what were your dreams and aspirations, would you say?
I always knew I wanted to do something to do with music. I always knew I wanted to entertain, but I just didn't know exactly what. So initially I started DJing, following after my dad and my brother. And I still love DJing, I still love doing that, and being in the background of music, but I always knew I was meant to be in the forefront.
Yeah.
So that's kind of how I just fell into it. I just knew eventually some point in my life I'm gonna do it.
Okay, and let's go to school times. What would you say, what was school times to you? Was it like hectic? Was it like, oh no, actually mess with this? Like what
I
like?
Hated school.
Okay.
I hated school. I just felt like in school, there was like, it's a very pivotal, important moment of your life. And I felt like when it was secondary school especially, it was like a lot of changes. I wouldn't say that I was like really running around with like the it girls. Actually, initially I was. And then eventually I started to break off and doing my own thing and finding who I was separately from that. I used to get in fights a lot with the boys in my secondary school. I used to hate them, they used to hate me, it is what it is. But we was always cool sometimes as well, but I think I was just really like a hothead in school. So that was kind of like a interesting experience for me. But as I got older and as I started to progress outside of secondary school into college and stuff like that, I feel like I kind of found myself and understood who I was more.
Okay, kind of like, I like the way I do my interviews, I like to dissect everything. So.
Okay.
I want to get deeper into like why do you think you were a hothead? Like, do you think it was a thing where you were oppositional to the teachers, or was it a thing, was it something going outside of school? Like what
I think
reason?
I was just reckless. I'm a risk taker. So I could just literally feel to do anything at any point in time. I think that was a lot, and as well, like, trying to figure out where I fit in. Like, I can do so many different things, and because I can do so many different things, I can be in so many different places. So it was pretty much trying to figure out, where do I fit in? And I realised I didn't fit in.
Mm-hmm.
So I just continued to do my own thing. But yeah, I was kind of reckless in school.
Okay, and did you go to uni after college? And if so, would you say it was useful if you did?
No, I didn't go to university because I felt like it just wasn't for me.
Mm.
I knew whatever I was going to do, I didn't need a degree. I don't feel like I need to ever fall back on a degree either. Like, touch wood. But yeah, it just wasn't for me. If I went to uni, I would have just sat at like in my lectures and just been on my phone, been on my laptop, just to be there.
Okay.
Like, I wouldn't have really cared about it, so I just knew I wasn't gonna waste my time doing it. Let me just continue doing what I wanna do and find my way outside of that kind of like construct.
Okay, and would you say like after school was it 9 to 5s or were you just out there kind of trying to find your way? Like, what would you say it was after school?
9 to 5s. I worked a few jobs, but every job I worked, I hated it. I just knew as well every job I was like, no, I don't like this. I don't like feeling like stifled. I just knew there's something more than just a 9 to 5 for me. So every 9 to 5 job I had, I ended up leaving, like, fighting for my life. So,
okay,
yeah.
Okay.
But I did that. I because I can kind of, like, do a whole bunch of different things. I did, like, odd jobs here and there,
mm-hmm.
things like that. But, yeah, it was legit, like.
Okay. Well, let's go on to the music. Like, obviously, growing up, like, how would you say, like, you, like, obviously there's listening, like, all in the yard listening to music, whatever our parents are playing in it, but
mm-hmm.
how would you say yourself you got into music?
I feel like, I just try to remember, music was always in my house, so it's like it was just bound for me to just get into it. But my dad had a lot of CDs, and then he never used to let us listen to all of the CDs, and then eventually I started to go and listen to them myself, and there was a lot of 50 Cent, Busta Rhymes, there was a lot of Lil' Kim and Foxy, like all those kind of sounds, that Alicia Keys, like we had everything, and then like old school music as well, and then I just started listening to it myself and figuring out, okay, I like hip hop, I like rap, I like this and like that, and I just started to go deeper by listening to artists like Slum Village and J Dilla,
okay.
MF Doom. I really started to go really deep into hip hop, Common, all that, listening to everything. And then I started expanding and listening to like Arabic music. That's like one
okay.
of my favourite genres as well, like Egyptian Arabic music. And then just kept going in like that.
Okay. And obviously, I'd say that. The first time I got acquainted was through the Notorious Freestyle, so that you might have been doing stuff from before that I wasn't aware of, but like, how would you say the process of that came about, kind of thing?
Notorious, that actually, I feel like it came out, like how I created it was by accident, but I feel like a lot of things that people create, that is like one of their biggest and best things is by accident. I saw someone listening to Notorious. There was at a party and it played, and I saw it on their like story, and I was like, oh my gosh, I remember this song as a kid. So I just grabbed the instrumental, and I was really, really going through some stuff at that time, and I just kind of wanted to just like flesh out how I felt, and wrote the song. I wrote another song actually on the same day, which is like the polar opposite, and I just said, you know what, this is me, this is what I want to do, this is how I'm going to come out with this. But prior to Notorious, I did have some songs,
okay.
I had some stuff on SoundCloud, I took it down. I just felt like, you know what, those are some old stuff.
Mm-hmm.
This is me, this is who I want to sound like, this is what I want to be like, and went with Notorious.
No, that's good. And I saw you put out the Parental Advisory mixtape last year, so kind of talk about like creating the mixtape and like how it came about.
Like after Notorious, I just started to go through a couple more instrumentals. I did Killer Me a Freestyle before Notorious.
Big
Chew. Yeah, that was another one And I did, I think it's Do It On The Tip before Notorious. So it was once I had Notorious, I kind of knew, okay, this is where I want to go with the mixtape. And I just created Bad Beef On The Block, and a bunch of other songs that's on there. And yeah, Parental Advisory came about because I feel like every single song, not every single song, but just my persona, my demeanor can be very like vulgar at times, very blunt, and it's just not a tape for kids, realistically.
Okay, okay,
what I'm
okay,
saying, I don't
okay.
rap for little kids, I rap for, you know, grown adults. So that's where Parental Advisory came from, just because of the content that's in that mixtape.
Okay, and obviously I checked out the EP while you wait, like proper mess with that, and would you say from the mixtape to the EP, was there growth, or would you just say that was just a natural progression kind of thing?
I think it was a natural progression. With the tape, it's not really an EP. That's not really, it's just three songs and a single that I had out. But with While You Wait, I think it was just me kind of like trying different things. SYM, for example, that's on there, I engineered that whole track myself.
Okay.
So it's just me trying those things and seeing, and like that was done a whole year and a half ago, those songs. So it was just literally me trying and figuring out different things, and I just put it out because I just said, you know what, I need some new songs out, I need to feed the people, and you put out something, even if they're old songs, just so something for everyone to listen to. So yeah, that's Why You Wait.
Okay, so let's get to the meat and potatoes of it.
Okay.
Obviously, my favourite track from it is Sneaky Link, innit? So
mm-hmm.
I'm trying to figure out what is a Sneaky Link?
What
like?
Is a Sneaky Link?
Like, obviously, this, because like, I feel like, yeah, people might not know, innit? So, like,
I think the song, it's kind of self explanatory in the song. A sneaky link is just someone that you are involved with in whatever way you want to be involved with. And you're just keeping it on the low. It doesn't necessarily mean that it's something like, you know, crazy as like having multiple people, but it's just, this is someone I want to keep on the low. I want to, like, see how this goes before I start announcing and doing anything else with this person. So that's what Sneaky Link is, to me.
Okay, and like, aside from the music, I'd say I'm really into the, just men and female relationships, because
yeah.
I feel like, especially now, it's like, I feel like a lot of people don't know where they're going, like, everyone's
mm-hmm.
just, everyone's in that kind of, like, purgatory kind of wave, innit,
yeah.
where, like, they don't know where it is, innit, so... For you, in it, what would you say, like, a quote-unquote sneaky link would have to do to, like, become, like, the main kind of boyfriend kind of thing?
Become the main? You just got to put in that work, you got to step up, you got to prove why you deserve to be the main. Because if you're a sneaky link, there's obviously a reason why you want to keep it quiet.
Mm-hmm.
So what, you got to find out what is it that you need to do so that you can make it into the main street. So...
Okay, okay. And like, in terms of like the overall like male perspective,
yeah,
what would you say are like some, even if it's just a couple, like what would you say are like big turn offs, like nah, like
ooh,
I could never mess with that, like that's just not me.
I don't like cringy guys.
Mm.
Like corny guys, like don't be corny.
Mm-hmm.
That's for me, that's a no no. I don't
mm-hmm.
like that corny stuff. Just be normal, be real. Another thing that will kind of turn me off is bad hygiene.
Okay.
Oh gosh, no.
No bad breath, we're not about that.
No bad hygiene. And what else is something that I kind of just, that's a no-no for me. Someone that talks too much.
Mm-hmm.
Like, keep the info on the wall. Sneaky link, you know?
okay, like, obviously, you said, like, what you like, what are your turn-offs are. I don't know if you know about the whole Red Sports space, but they're, like, kind of going I don't know, for me it's too much in it. They're kind of going against him in a way.
What's that?
That's like, I don't know if you know about Fresh and Fit or like, obviously RIP to him, Kevin Samuels, but basically they're like, they're on the opposition kind of to like women in a way, but
yeah,
kind of trying to teach men how to be men. But for me, not doing it the right way.
Right.
So like, I was going to ask your opinion on that, but if like...
I don't have no opinion on that.
No, that's fair. That's
you
fair.
Guys do what you do. I have no opinion on that.
That's fair.
All.
That's fair. But yeah, no. Let's take it back to the music. Obviously,
yeah,
like I checked out the PGG freestyle. Proper
yeah.
fucked with it.
Thank you.
Obviously, saw that you produced, engineered, yeah, directed everything. So
okay,
like, kind of yeah, talk about like why you did that and like the process of it as well.
Again, PGG kind of came by accident. I actually initially was writing for a different freestyle. It was just going to be a whole different freestyle. And I had parts of what's in PGG now that was on that freestyle. And I ended up just picking up my brother's laptop. We was working on While You Wait. I needed him to do some stuff for it. And he left the house and he was like, okay, there's my laptop. So I just started like playing around. And then ended up making the PGG beat.
Yeah, okay.
Completely by accident.
But were you producing before that, or was that the first thing you produced?
That's like my first beat, like fully that I produced.
Okay.
So I've like done some stuff. I've added some stuff into some other beats that I've got out. But that was the first one. It's like, okay, yeah, this is like fully me producing it.
Okay.
So yeah, that was quite interesting, but it ended up sounding great. And then I just said, you know what, I got a couple bars for this, let me just keep writing. And then I made the full freestyle, and it is what it is today. So.
No, that's dope, that's dope. And obviously, like, I see from your socials, you're in the studio, you're making music.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, in terms of what's next, is it like a single, is it a project, like, video?
Single's next. Everything else, we're just gonna, when it's time, it's time. But right now, it's just gonna be a single that's coming up next.
Okay, okay. And like, let's say, like, pick up three, like, artists worldwide, like, who would you wanna collab with? Like, who?
Ooh. That's current right now, or just in general?
No, in general.
In
yeah.
general. 50 Cent, love him, that's my favorite, like, rapper. Who else would I like to collab with? I think I would really like to collab with an artist, a UK artist called Enny.
Yeah,
I think she's super
cool.
Duper dope. It would be interesting to kind of hear what kind of vibes we can create, because we do, obviously we're both female rappers, but I feel like we have different energies.
Yeah.
And I'd love to hear how that would sound. Someone else that I would love to do a track with, Nicki Minaj.
Cool.
Why not?
Cool, cool.
Why not?
Yeah, no, she's, and obviously she kind of just gave the, well, she gave the light to Ice Spice.
Yeah.
Which I think is, well, I like Ice Spice, so I think it's a good thing.
Yeah.
But yeah, I feel like in the UK it's still kind of a weird space between like people calling it female rap, or
right.
is it like overall rap, like, What's your kind of take on that, really?
I really don't mind people saying female rap, or rap in general. Like, for me, I'm an artist, so I do everything.
Mm.
So everything's going to be categorized anyway. That's not going to stop. People are going to have to feel like they've got to categorize everything. So female rap, rap in general, at the end of the day, as long as our music gets played, that kind of really doesn't matter.
Do. And okay, kind of like wrapping up, but like looking to the future as well, like
yeah.
what would you say, like in 5 years, what's your kind of like aims or kind of like direction you want to go in, kind of thing?
In 5 years, I definitely still want to be about, but I really want to be doing like other things. I really want to get back into songwriting for other artists as well, and just like, I don't want to be corny, but world domination, innit?
Yeah,
I just
want
to be able to just be all over the place and literally still be me while I'm all over the place too. So yeah, that's in 5 years, that's what I want to be doing.
No, dope, yeah. And obviously, I would like to end things. I just like to give it to the artists. If there's like anything you wanna promote, any message you wanna say, anything you wanna leave to the people, like what would it be?
What I wanna leave to the people, just work hard. Like really, really work hard. Put in the work. Write your raps. Like write your music. Really, like go in. Don't just be half-assed with it, because people are gonna tell. You're going to be able to tell who's half-assed, who's really, really about it. So write your music, go in, keep going in. Oh, apologies. And yeah, that's what I want to leave with the people.
Yeah, that's dope. Yeah, Monza, I really appreciate you for coming on.
Thank you for having me.
It's big love, and I hope, like, wherever your career takes you, it's, like, big places, and I've taken in the music, and I can tell, like, you put a lot into it, so...
Yeah.
No, it's definitely like my applause to you and like what all the team is doing as well.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Yeah, love. I will leave it there. Big up, stay grinding, and we are.